one thing I want to make very clear, right? I mean, there is a very narrow conception of what a database is by most people, you know, and you think of this as something that, you know, runs in kind of gray or beige boxes in some kind of dark room and so on, in a company that might not be very sexy to them in terms of technology and so on, insurances, etc., which of course do good work as well, right? But, you know, people maybe don't identify this as a particular kind of, a live field with, you know, interesting research challenges and so on, right? Maybe people think of databases just as a place where you throw things so that you can find them later. And that's clearly one way to think of them.
Okay, confession time. At some point in my life, this was indeed what I thought database management was all about. Let's see if Professor Christoph Koch of the IC School at EPFL can radically change my mind.
Database systems, they satisfy many different needs, you know. And I mean, one thing is, of course, to organize information and to find it effectively.
And if you think about it, it's not really clear how to best organize your data so that you can have simple, fast access to your data whenever you want, especially when you have large data sets. I mean, that's part of what our brains are supposed to do, but we humans tend to forget a lot.
There's usually things called query languages, right, which allow you to, in very flexible ways, specify what you want to find in the data, and they help you find it, they look for you, right? So usually you don't have to write programs in a classical general purpose Turing complete programming language to find the answers from the data, but there is particular kind of languages that make this particularly easy to do. So you write less code, and it's less error prone, it's harder to make mistakes, etc.
Yes, seriously, compared to programming languages like C or Java, query languages are wonderfully easy to use. But making the retrieval of data easy to use is just one of the many big challenges of database management.
Another very important aspect to most database systems is the support for changes to the data and changes that might be caused by multiple different users.
Hmm. Let's give an example.
So, for example, if you are a bank, you know, you want to support customers accessing the database of the bank and doing transactions, business transactions, moving money and so on, in parallel, maybe internationally at thousands of different places at the same time, right? It would be very bad if, for example, you know, UBS or Credit Suisse or any such large bank would only allow maybe to people to retrieve money from one ATM at a time. And while one person works on one ATM to get money out of it, nobody else in the world can do anything with the bank, right? So it is very important that you support concurrency.
Concurrency is the ability of a system to deal with multiple accesses in an order which cannot be foreseen, as is the case every day for banks' databases.
So there, the kind of protocols for making sure that the data doesn't get corrupted can be very complicated. Or, in other words, make these protocols that are guaranteeing that nothing wrong happens efficient can be very difficult.
In fact, guaranteeing safe, efficient, and large-scale concurrency is provably difficult.
There is actually result very famous in computer science called the CAP theorem that has been talked about a lot in the context of big data and recent, you know, efforts in the context of, you know, building massively parallel, you know, systems for data management, which basically says that, I want to oversimplify here, you know, that you cannot really truly have a system that that is distributed, manages and changes data, distribute nodes all at the same time, okay, and that truly scales. That means that as you have larger and more complicated needs, you can just buy more computers and it will work out. And I'm very imprecise here intentionally, right? But ultimately, it's an observation that is very relevant to this context of transaction processing in database systems. And in that context, it had been actually observed decades before the so-called CAP theorem claim was coined.
That's bad. So how do we get around this impossibility theorem?
We have to live with this. This is ultimately a fundamental impossibility. I have to play tricks to make it in practice work well enough that it can be used. And this is a very rich field. It can be approached in many different ways. But naively speaking, if I really just think of this as, you know, a huge globally distributed data store, you know, with lots of machines that all just have parts of the data, you know, and I want to make sure that, you know, transactions moving data around, you know, can happen on an arbitrary large scale. This is you know, at least theoretically impossible. In practice, you can do all kinds of messy things, but it's a very difficult challenge.
Efficient concurrency is both very difficult and crucial, but there's an even more crucial problem with database management, which is literally worth billions of dollars.
Another thing is, never losing any data, right? So a database system is supposed to guarantee you that in a certain kind of model of the world, nothing bad will ever happen to your database.
Can we really guarantee that data will never get lost?
So, of course, if there's a nuclear strike on us or something like that, and all the computers are broken, right? There's nothing I can do as a software person to avoid that, right?
Right.
But the assumption is, suppose you have working hardware or enough redundant hardware, right? You can craft software that guarantees that no failure of software, for example, a power outage or, a software failure in one of the application programs that might be buggy or something like that, will cause the data to be permanently corrupted, right? So there is a need to kind of support, recoverability if there's a crash of the operating system, for example.
The youngest among you may not have lived it, but in the old days, we did not have the internet. So whenever we had some important document, we had to make a lot of copies of it. But every now and then we forgot to make these copies and our computers would crash. And thus we would lose all of our data. And that was bad, very bad. But it was only bad for the persons whose computer crashed. These days, data is more and more digitized, and losing data in such a way can be a matter of national security.
The big banks, they will not have, little gold coins in a bucket that is labeled with your name anymore to correspond to your bank account, and they will not even have everything on paper at a certain point in time, right? So if the database of that bank gets lost, the money is gone. At least they don't know anymore how to assign the different, amounts of money that different people own and so on, right? And such a loss, particularly for, let's say, a big bank, could have, global, could cause a global crisis.
Yep, that'd be bad, seriously bad.
So making sure that nothing ever bad happens to your data, right, is a very, very important thing, right? And it can be approached in different ways. And it is also about physical hardware redundancy and about making, manufacturing reliable hardware and so on. But it's also a big software problem.
Big money is at stake here.
The global IT industry, right? I don't know the current numbers. I remember that it was something like $1.4 trillion a year, I think 3 years ago or something like that. Probably now it is a substantial amount larger. And, it's clear a bit of definition what you include there, right? But this IT industry is not so much about video games, and it's not so much about even, let's say, your desktop operating system software or something like that. It's also not so much about, let's say, supercomputers and scientific computing, because supercomputers, I remember in that figure at the time, made $5 billion out of this $1.4 trillion, per year in kind of, market share. So, a very large fraction of this is hardware for, driving the IT infrastructure inside large corporations, etc. It's database software, it's application software, it's consulting, it's the manpower to actually do this stuff. So it's really, the software-wise, you could argue that actually at the heart of the IT industry, there's these database systems, right? That are something like the operating system of these application software, like SAP or PeopleSoft, that runs our companies and our industry nowadays, right? So the global market value or the global sales in database system software itself, maybe something like $15 billion a year, which is a good number, right? But if you talk about all the ecosystem around them that could not exist without this database system, we're talking about more than $1 trillion a year, right? And basically the way we live today would be unthinkable, without having database systems at the core, because everything that, that works, that we use, that today's life is about is somewhere in a database. And, it's in the banks, it's in the insurance companies, it's in the big, manufacturers, it's with the big commerce that do sales, Of course, the big supermarket chains, they do a lot of, they have a lot of database systems and a lot of, data mining on top of the database systems, etc., right? So, it's very central, and some of the core scientific and research problems are also very interesting and actually very difficult to solve, right? And they are very separate from let's say, the applications. You don't have to worry about banks if that's not your thing, right? But let's say understanding, you know, asynchronicity and parallelism and concurrency, as it becomes relevant in the context of data management, that's some of the most beautiful and most interesting problems in computer science.
Wow. I take back what I used to think. Database management is not merely about throwing stuff somewhere you can retrieve them from later on. Database management is a big, big deal. And there's a lot of research to be done in this area.
As a research area, I think it's a very exciting area because it's very open to kind of new incoming, inseminating ideas. So you can, if you have, let's say, a love for algorithms, for example, you can do algorithms work and it can be good research in my field, data management, databases, right? If you like theory, you can do great work there. If you like logic, if you like systems, if you like operating systems, these kind of things, distributed systems, it's very open to ideas coming from other areas, and you can apply them in that space because data plays a role anywhere, and the definition of my area's research field is very broad. Right, we don't just work on kind of classical relational databases the way you see them maybe in banks and so on, but it's really very open to kind of new directions.
Your electricity service provider is obviously using a DBMS to manage billing, client-related issues, to handle fault data, etc.
The relational model has become the most popular model, and that is not about to change anytime soon, I think.